afternoon, everyone. Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Health Show, and today it's really sunny here. It's beautiful. But today we have the final installment of our interview with Vicente Molina. She's going to be talking about allergies, a little more about allergies, a little bit about bone health, and a little bit about calcium. So check it out.
And so if someone has, let me just use yeast as an example. Over time, overexposure, can that cause allergy as well?
It seems so, because like rice is not an allergen in North America. Typically, it's one of the foods that is safe for us. Mm-hmm. But in Asia, there are rice allergies much more commonly.
Sure.
Now, one of the things that can happen and did happen, like in my era, before your era, mothers used to feed their babies foods early in life because they thought, wow, that shows my baby is so clever. Like, they can eat ice cream or they can eat whatever, and they're only 2 months old. And most of it, of course, dribbles down their chin, and, you know. But they'd still be feeding infants instead of just breast milk, the ideal thing, or formula if for some reason that won't work. They're feeding them some food off the family table. And the infant's gastrointestinal tract is not intact. It's just forming. It's in kind of an immature state, and proteins can leak through. It is like a leaky gut situation. And so feeding a child dairy, for example, early can lead to a dairy allergy or that kind of thing. So some of the allergies that have developed were because of that kind of upbringing. Now, there's some interesting stuff, too. With peanut allergies, they did a very fascinating research study that was based in Britain and also in Israel. And in Britain, a lot of kids were tested for peanut allergies. You know, they take it into the lab and do that little injection of a bit of peanut serum, and lots of the kids would end up with peanut allergies. And in Israel, they didn't do that. And they found that they had hardly any peanut allergies in Israel, whereas they would have much more in Britain.
Hmm.
Seems like even some of the testing where you introduce this tiny little bit of peanut protein into the system for a well-intended reason, it could actually lead to an allergy.
Hmm.
So anyway, there's the whole world. I guess science of nutrition is quickly evolving.
Yeah.
It came into being about 100 years ago, like vitamin C, the first beginning recognition of vitamins was about 100 years ago. And so it's a pretty lively field. Like we don't know that much, and we're learning a lot. It's quite fun.
Well, how much do we really need to know, too, right?
Yeah, well, part of it, people that are good observers of their own system can know quite a bit, and then a lot of people are started off on not that great a track and the way the family was eating, and they're trying to find out how to eat much better. As we get older, we go, yikes, I better take care of this body if I wanted to get me through a few more decades.
And let's see. Let's talk a little bit about calcium, because that's a big deal, and maybe some other nutrients. Besides B12 or D, because we already talked about that with Brenda. What are some of the calcium, and what are some of the other nutrients that you think are really essential?
Well, let's just talk about calcium first, and then we'll come back and see what other ones we have time for. But the calcium is one that you definitely can get from but you really need to eat greens a lot, like even every meal. You could be including greens. And I found that there was like a pretty hefty handful of kale that could go into your smoothie or be included in your salad. There are certain types of greens where the calcium is very, very well absorbed, like 50 to 70% of the calcium is absorbed. And compare that with cow's milk or tofu, where it's about 31% of the calcium is absorbed. And so that's the kind of usual standard. And then with almonds, where about 20% is absorbed, and same with sesame seeds, somewhere in that range. And then with spinach, a lovely green for many reasons, but the calcium is not well absorbed. We're down to about 5% with spinach or beet greens or with starch. So there's quite a range here. So you really want to carefully pick what greens you want if you're relying on them for your calcium source. Now, you could take a calcium pill as a supplement, but if you want to get up to your 1,000 milligrams a day, then you better pick kale and Napa cabbage or Chinese cabbage and, let's see, okra is another good one, and broccoli. These are all really well-absorbed calcium. So we've been very specific in our books and created food guides that show, okay, if you want to get up to recommended calcium levels, here's how you do it. Another good calcium food is oranges and orange juice. So these are good, and figs are good. Almonds, as Sarah, or calcium absorption is a bit lower than with some of the other foods, but it's still a good source. So almonds, sesame seeds, sesame tahini. And then we get little tiny bits of calcium from all sorts of foods. But the greens are really the heavy hitters in terms of calcium. And I have been interested in this because I have followed my own bone density. And since I was 50, I've had it tracked every couple years. And this, I'm 69 now. And I started checking my bone density when I was 50. I went to a endocrinologist and I said, I'm just going through menopause. I am vegan. I'm not going to take any hormone replacement, and I'm interested to see if, you know, I can maintain good bone health. And so it's been tracked every couple of years since then. And what I found out was that, first of all, at the beginning, we used to think, okay, vegans don't need as much calcium because they aren't eating these excessive amounts of protein, so it's probably not such a problem. So I wasn't worrying too much about calcium. And I did lose bone density around menopause, which is normal, but I didn't want to lose that much.
Then I
stopped being way down in calcium. I was getting like 500 milligrams or 600 when we needed at least 1,000, better, a bit more than that. And so then I upped my calcium. I made sure that I would either be eating all those greens and all the other foods I mentioned, or I would top it up with a little calcium supplement. And those are usually only about 250 milligrams, but it's a good way to top it up. Then my bone density kind of leveled out, and then I started doing weight-bearing exercise every day. One of the inspiring people in the vegan and often raw community is Ruth Heydrich, who's a runner, you know, she's doing Ironman triathlons, and she's had her bone density tracked since she was menopausal, and her bone density had gotten better actually, and her calcium intake wasn't that high, but she was doing so much weight bearing exercise, you know, out there pounding, and it takes having a little bit of a shock on your calcium, like to keep it in the bone. Not hard, but just what running does or cycling even. You've got a little bit of pressure. The bones seem to respond well to that. You know, they like to be used. Then they hold on to their calcium. They retain it. They get it there in the first place. They don't let go of it. So I made sure that then after that I would get an hour of weight-bearing exercise a day. And then the next thing, and so my bone density started going up very slightly. Next thing I did was make sure I got enough vitamin D.
Your question of the day is, what did you think of the last 2 weeks of interviews with Vasanta Molina and Brenda Davis? I want to know. Give me your honest opinion. Post it down below. Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Health Show. Together we change the health of the world, one show at a time.